What do you think about job creation in the conventional industry? Because I mean, in conventional and large industry, it's mostly moving away from labor intensive work and it's moving more into automation. So do you think, I mean, that is the right step? But in that case, wouldn't MSME have a greater role in job creation?
Yes, you are rightly pointed out. India needs labor intensive technologies. India requires labor intensive planning. India requires labor intensive policies. But now everything is being imported from outside. Even experts are being imported from outside. That is a condition. That is the situation in India. And when you look at the experts who have been imported, I don't want to mention their names. Almost when you look at their biography, almost all these experts were advisors of financial institutions in America, which have collapsed now. So they have no jobs there in America, so they have migrated to India.
So the financial institutions...
I don't want to mention about the name right. And go to that aspect.
Okay.
So not only they are experimenting a failed doctrine here, even failed experts are advising the government. This is very serious as far as our economy is concerned. Our economy cannot afford such a
are you saying that these people or these so-called experts are taking a more Western view toward what is a very Indian problem?
No, there is no Western or Indian. That cannot be. Everything is universal. What is best for India, that we can accept. There is no doubt about it. But the thing is, Indian conditions, it has certain unique features. That also we should understand. When 2008 financial crisis that started from Wall Street and spread to almost all the countries, I was in Geneva in 2009. There was a 12-day long seminar. In that seminar, almost all experts from all over the world, they have attended. Many of them pointed out that this crisis has started from Wall Street and affected almost all the countries in the world. And there is one country that is least affected, that is India. And they want to learn from India how, why they could withstand, they were able to achieve this thing, that is, they are the least affected. Of course, it is affected on some certain foreign related, export related sectors, but as far as the common man is concerned, they are not affected.
But that would bring you back to what I had asked originally, which is about, then do you think that, you know, if you're talking about labor intensive industries, again, you know, conventional industries seem to be going more and more towards automation, then what about job creation and job growth in the MSME and therefore boosting the MSME sector more? I mean, do you think that we are going in the right direction, the country?
When you look at countries which have advanced in a short time, for example, Japan, South Korea, all these countries which were called Asian tigers previously. You look at that, there was government support to the industry. Secondly, the government had selectively injected foreign elements to their country. This was there. In Japanese agriculture sector, the price of rice was very high. Everybody suggests that if you import foreign rice, the price can be brought down, but the government refused. No, we will not do it. So they could protect their country. That's why it became the most industrialized nation in the country. That was the story before 1990s.
But in our case, that would also be hit by shortages in certain food grades, isn't it?
No, I'm telling only one example regarding the basic approach.
Right. Basically.
So the government has to be selective. You cannot make it as a wayside in. Where anybody can enter without any permission, that is the way in which FDI is brought to India. There is absolutely no control. They will come and bulldoze all small micro sectors and they will establish. This type of thing, this should not happen. If on one side that is happening and on the other side the government is trying to create employment, this will not match. There will be a gross mismatch between these two things. So the government policies should be encouraging employment generation. That is totally lacking as far as these reforms are concerned. That's why we are attacking the reforms.
But what Niti Aayog does mostly is to make suggestions for reforms.
Yeah.
So I mean, their reforms are not, I mean, their suggestions are not the final thing of the government, but I mean, like, for example, you said that in the resolution that it is limping on the social sector side.
Mm-hmm.
So why do you say that, that they are limping on the social sector side?
But because when you look at the all the documents, all their proposals, suggestions, advices to the government, they're all against the concerned common man, the lower strata of the society in that sector. For example, even government has to disown their own guidance. So we are maintaining a very expensive exercise in the name of this think tank, Team India, etc. We are maintaining an expensive exercise. Even their proposals, government has to reject. For example, taxing on agricultural income. You know, Prime Minister said the all life-saving medicine should be available to common man at low price. This Niti Aayog proposed. The price control should be removed. Then labor laws. They proposed all these anti-labor proposals, and labor ministry and tripartite mechanism has to reject it. So, if that is the case, in many, for example, Supreme Court said equal pay for equal wages, equal pay for equal work.
Right.
Then they wanted that should be removed from the statute. So that means they are all talking against the aspirations of the people. Who needs to be protected? All those is going against. So that's why we have asked in the resolution.
Mm-hmm.
Is it required to keep such an expensive exercise in the name of Niti Aayog?
Right. You know, what about reduction in EPF contribution by employers? I mean, with such low social security that laborers have in India, should workers be subject to further cuts?
Yeah, that's also a paradox in the functioning of our policy making mechanism. On one side, the labor ministry has brought a social security coverage to all people with about 14 benefits to the people. This one historical and revolutionary law on one side. On another side, Niti Aayog is proposing that all these things should be gradually, progressively reduced. So this paradox is also, nobody can explain this paradox. So these two are taking place simultaneously.
But otherwise, is there also, I mean, parity in the amount of contribution? You know, many sections have been asking for an increase in the employers' contributions directly,
mm-hmm.
as well as to raise the basic wage,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
because that is what is the contribution is based on,
mm-hmm.
so that the employers' contribution can also be increased. So do you think currently there is parity,
no.
or should that be reformed?
EF and ESI are two largest social security schemes in the world, one of the largest.
But that's because we have a very high population in
workforce. That's true. But it's also protecting the so-called organized sector with this thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it is all working on well-settled principles. It is now the workers also very well comfortable with this type of system. Even though we many times complain about this is not sufficient. It has to go forward. But Niti Aayog has proposed that this contribution should be reduced. That even employer should be exempted from contributing. So whether we should keep such a institution in this country is our question.
So you know, a lot of politicians and political bodies seem to be in favor of farm loan waivers, as does most recently Yogi Adityanath. You know, but Niti Aayog seems to be against it.
No, farm loan waiver should not be a political program. It has to be a program in which it should be a part of our welfare schemes. Wherever necessary, that has to be done, because people take loans and then they are not able to repay. There may be some calamity in their farming sector. So naturally the government can do it, but loan melas and other things, it's all political, which are, we have no sincerity, nothing to do with these things. That should be, the politics should be kept away from all these welfare activities.
But the government says that the Mudra Yojana is doing well.
Okay.
But at the same time, the indication is that, you know, MSME is not doing that well. And whatever money they are taking in the form of loans is going towards buying raw material for existing business rather than expanding to incorporate more labor and therefore give more jobs.
Yes.
Right. So what would you advise the government in this?
Now the basic, it's also a capitalist concept. Of course, the Mudra Yojana has supported our small scale sector. That's a real thing. But only by giving loans, no industry can survive. There should be certain several. They should have a congenial atmosphere, environment in which they can develop. Second thing is, the government should be active in supporting, finding their market, everything. In all aspects, they should get that support. For that, you have to look to China. China knows Indian market better than our Indian people. No, you just see. Within the last 3 years, the entire fireworks market has been captured by China, by the cheap fireworks. So where is Shivakashi and other people? Now, I was seeing for the last two, our Vishu, that celebrations are there. Nobody is buying Shivakashi fireworks. Everybody is running after China firework, which is available for half the price.
And the more you buy, the more there is dumping.
Ah, yes, dumping. And even Ganapati idol, that is bought from beautiful Ganapati idols bought from China. So where are our industries? Where are our people? So that means they know our market better than our thing.
But then that also has to do with our import policies, right?
No, it's all part of the overall policy, not only import, market system. Why our agricultural farming sector is failing? Because we don't have a marketing system across the country. Many countries have. We are still, our poor farmers are still relying on middlemen. That's it. So the government can do so many wonders in these sectors. Instead of only FDA can serve the country, it's all rubbish.
Very, very succinctly, you know, which specific labor policy reforms do you object to within the last 3 years specifically that I would like to look at?
The labor policy that is...
And if you can just, like when you're talking about them, can you also just say a little about like, you know, this labor policy and, you know, what will be the impact of these reforms if, you know, they come about?
No. Labor policy actually works on a particular philosophy. Industrial peace has to be achieved. Then industry has to develop, labor welfare has to be achieved. So industrial development and labor welfare together should go, and it should create a industrial peaceful atmosphere in the industry. So there is regarding that International Labor Organization is working. They have created so many labor standards across the country. 186 countries now they are bound to follow this international standard set by ILO.